in honor of Ira Glass, who is going to be here on Saturday, okay, and I've structured my talk in three acts, like this American Life. So I'm not sure if I could imitate his voice, but maybe like act one. So in every backyard, there is so many species of plants and animals, and everyone is polished by natural selection, polished stones over the generations to survive and reproduce in a challenging environment. And some of them have been studied in extraordinary detail, including many by our faculty at Cornell, such as Nelson Hairston and his colleagues. And when you really understand these species, the number and sophistication of their adaptation can be breathtaking. So every species has a story, and that story really needs to be told, basically. So I'm going to give you one example, which is this beautiful picture here. How many people know what this is? Well, it'd be better because it's looking better. Water strider. Wonderful insects which glide over the water. Most insects, when they fall over the water, of course, they can't fly. They get trapped, and that's what the water strider feeds on. Their anatomical adaptations are so wonderful. Their front and back legs are like pontoons, so they lift themselves above the water. And then their middle pair of legs are like oars that they row with. If you zoom in on the morphology of their feet, then eons of natural selection have caused their feet to be so hydrophobic, so that they don't break through the water, that you could stack 15 water striders on top of each other, like you're a turtle, and they still won't break through. And the ultrastructure of the legs are now being used as to manufacture waterproof fabrics. So, and they also use ripples as communication, and just the same way that we hear by detecting sound waves, they hear by detecting ripples. So at the same time that they're supporting themselves on the water, when the ripples come, their legs flex, and the equivalent of hearing takes place. And not only can they sense things, but they could actually communicate by beating ripples on the water. And all of this has been worked out by scientists over the decades. But now, however, our story takes a dark turn. And here's another adaptation of the water striders. The headline here says, male water striders evolved antennae to grab females by the eyes. And here's some of the text. This is in Discover magazine. The worst sex you've ever had pales in comparison to what female water striders have to put up with. Put it this way. You have never been held down by your eyes. As a female skates over the surface of ponds and lakes, males will try to force themselves upon it. She resists by struggling vigorously. In some species, males can avoid being thrown off by antennae that have evolved in an antler-shaped harvest trends. And this indicates a message, I think, which is very, very important from evolution in your backyard and elsewhere, which is that evolution, natural selection does not make everything nice. Natural selection explains the good, the bad, the beautiful, and the ugly. Often it favors traits that are short, that are selfish, me, not you, short-sighted, now, not then. And so, now the traits that we might consider benign in the human sense of the word, they can be favored by natural selection, but only under special conditions. Only under special conditions. And we really want to know what those conditions are. So, we continue. It turns out that water striders actually differ. Males differ quite a bit in their sexual behavior. Some act like sexual predators and are as described, basically. They simply hunt for females and attempt to mate with them coercively. But some are gentlemen and basically wait to be asked before performing in the union. And so we want to know, why are these differences maintained in water striders? And my former grad student, Omar Elderkar, did a series of elegant experiments. One of the nice things about experimenting with the species in your backyard is that often it's very inexpensive. You need some enamel paint and you need some kiddie pools and things like that. And so you don't necessarily need fancy equipment for this. And so males differ enormously in their aggressiveness towards females. These differences are stable. And what Omar did at first was simply to create pools out of water. And each pool had six females and six males. But the composition of the males varied from being all psychopaths
to all gentlemen. And so what happened? What he found was that in every pool containing both types, the psychopathic males had an advantage. So there's no advantage to being a gentleman in any pool. So on this basis alone, you would think that the psychopath would win, and it's a puzzle why the gentlemen are maintained in the population. But there's another part to the story, which is that in the pools for psychopaths, the females were so terrorized that they couldn't eat, and of course then they couldn't lay eggs. And so the eggs that were laid in these pools with all the psychopaths was less than half in the pools with all gentlemen, in which the females were allowed to feed, and therefore to lay more eggs. So now we have what I study a lot called multi-level selection theory, an illustration of natural selection operating at two scales. So multi-level selection theory in a nutshell is that selfishness feeds altruism within groups. In this example, psychopaths feed the gentlemen. But altruistic groups meet selfish groups. The groups with the altruists are much better than the groups with the psychopaths. And then in this case, what the balance out is that the mix is maintained in the population. So the selfish types are being maintained by within group selection, the altruistic types are being maintained by between group selection. And so the species in your backyard are not only are they entertaining to learn about, but they're also shedding light on some very fundamental questions about evolution of altruistic and selfish behavior. Well, I couldn't finish Act One of my talk without referring to my wife Ann Clark, who's right here, and she's the one that studies the crows. That have you all seen the crows with markings on their wings? So. There you go. So Ann studies these with Kevin McGowan. This is a long-term population now running about 26 years. And Ann promises to write a book on crows, which will be totally factual except for one thing. She won't tell you that they're crows. And what you'll find is in this book is that it's all recognizable as some weird human drama. As the social life of crows is really much like our own social life, even more bizarre in spite of something, more like a Tolkien trilogy, something like this. So this crow here, this is XX, is that right? And it was born in 2000, he was born in 2005, so he's 10 years old now, and the poor guy, he must be a loser because he's still living at home. He hasn't managed to find another place. Still living with his dad, but that's not going very well because his mother has died, and now his dad now is taken up with another female, so his stepmom is there, and dad's kind of nervous because you know why. So this is part of the drama that's going on in your backyard with the crows. And crows are more closely related to dinosaurs than they are to us. So this has nothing to do with historical relationships, phylogenetic relationships. This has to do with the fact that all species are pounded into shape by natural selection, and often the shape that other species are pounded into resembles the shape that we have been pounded into. So that's why it's so important to think in terms of natural selection. Okay, well, Act Two, genetic evolution and warp drive. Everything I've told you so far is based on natural selection operating over very long periods of time, basically making species the way they are now. And that's the way Darwin thought about it. Darwin and everyone else during his time assumed that evolution is a slow process that requires hundreds of thousands of generations for adaptation to evolve. Today we know that genetic evolution is much faster, taking place on ecological timescale. That means that the species in your backyard are changing before their eyes, and the individuals in your backyard might actually be different than the individuals in your backyard, as strange as that might seem. But this is the kind of work that Nelson does on Zapia in zooplankton. Really elegant work on zooplankton on this topic. And the strongest selection pressures, of course, are often caused by humans. So humans, of course, have this huge environmental impact. We know that that's true ecologically, but it's also true in an evolutionary sense. We're basically causing the species to evolve in front of our eyes. Now, here's the one person. in New York City. And so if you look at New York City, you have all these parks. There's Central Park and all of these other parks. And so he sampled the mice from these different parks, and he's done genetic analyses. And without going into the details, what you can see is basically these little blocks are quite different from each other. What it means is that there's enough isolation among these parks so that these mice populations have started to differentiate from each other, just as if they were on isolated islands. Parks in New York City are like islands. And he's done some very sophisticated analyses of these parks, which is the gene flow is based not just on distance from here to there, because mice pull up corridors, right? So that if there's corridors of tree canopy, then the mice can move along those corridors, and that will be kind of gene flow, which prevents them from differentiating from each other. And so with some very sophisticated GIS modeling, he produces graphs like these, which basically show these kind of corridors of dispersal, which cause these populations either to become isolated or to become connected to each other because they're connected with corridors. And this leads to some very interesting ideas about how we can manage our wildlife and genetic diversity of our wildlife by making a kind of a porous landscape so that they can travel from one place to another. Here's another example that Jason gave. This is a weed that typically lives in fields, but it also starts to inhabit these little soil islands in the city. And just imagine what that would mean in terms of dispersal. So what kind of dispersal would be best in this situation as opposed to this situation? It turns out that this has resulted in the evolution of seed morphology. Whereas in this field situation, you have seeds which disperse on the wind, and in this situation, you have seeds that just drop and fall in plains. So there is strong evolution on dispersal ability in these seeds. He's a co-author of a paper that's in press, and the first author is actually a graduate student at Cornell University. So forget about evolution in your backyard. How about evolution in your home? So there's a whole field that's springing up on the indoor biome, in which you can learn that indoor environments comprise a pretty big chunk of land area, even more than some ecosystems, natural ecosystems, is the indoor environment. And so a study of just 9 habitats in each of 40 houses in North Carolina, USA, documented more than 8,000 bacterial and archaeal taxa through molecular detection. While a study of 50 houses in North Carolina noted more than 750 arthropod species, without more than 100 species per house, dozens of fungal species have been cultured from showers and rains alone. This makes you think a little creepy. Actually, you shouldn't. I think one of the big surprises is that we used to think that all germs were bad, and if we could sterilize ourselves, that would be a good thing. That is totally false. We've been coexisting with a biome, a dense, diverse community inside ourselves, in our skin, and in our habitat, and they're not all bad for us. So much that if you get rid of them all, that could be part of the problem. A lot of allergies and immune system dysfunction are based on the fact that we've gotten rid of our microbiome, and we have to rethink what that means, basically. The idea that all species are bad for us, that live in and on us, is something which is not true at all. So leave those dozens of fungal species in your drain alone. That's what I say.
Let your kids play in the dirt.
No, that's true. That's true. The study showed that is true. There was a study in Finland, which looked at skin allergies as a function of the microbes on the surface of your skin and the amount of vegetation in your house and lawn, and the amount of vegetation within a 3-kilometer radius, okay? And it turns out that kind of a radius is important. If you live in a place where there's not a lot of vegetation in a 3-kilometer radius, that is reflected by what's on your skin, and that is reflected on your allergies. So So it's very, very interesting and important for health care. And so we have rapid evolution. The species, especially the species that we're trying to kill, have a way of just like pests, you know, you all know about agricultural pests and how they evolve resistance. Well, so do these pests. And here's an amazing example where these are cockroaches. This is a peanut butter bait. This is a jelly bait. And because our cockroach poisons are basically sweet, then what that's selected for is cockroaches that no longer are attracted to sweet. They avoid anything sweet, as strange as that might seem. And there they are clustered on the peanut butter. That's not a poison bait there. It's just something that's sweet. We bred the taste of sweet out of them. And so that's an amazing example of evolution in action. What's that? Yeah, that's one of the most common baits for rats. And I think that they both evolved to be immune to the bait, but also by behavioral means, they won't eat the bait. I don't know, maybe you can flesh that out. And there's a lot of social learning that's also true for deer avoidance. A lot of this is cultural evolution, not genetic evolution. So if you shoot deer, the deer, you know, they learn to avoid it pretty well. So there's a lot of sophistication in that. Okay, well now we come to Act 3, which in some ways is my favorite act, beyond genetic evolution. Nowadays, if you say the word evolution, almost everyone hears the word genes. And yet Darwin knew nothing about genes. For Darwin, evolution was about variation, selection, and heredity, which is a resemblance between parents and offspring. But with the discovery of Mendel and his genes and the advent of the science of genetics, then the study of evolution became very highly gene-centric, as if genes were the only mechanism of inheritance. And it turns out that that is not true. There's other ways that parents can resemble offspring. And this wonderful book, Evolution in Four Dimensions, is one that I assign first text in all of my classes. It's an academic book, but well written, so I really recommend that you get it. And what it shows is that the other mechanisms of inheritance, we have genetic inheritance, there's epigenetic inheritance, which is basically changes in gene expression that are transgenerational. So how you are is not just what genes you have, but what genes are expressed, which is transgenerational. And there's forms of social learning that are found in many species. And then finally, there's forms of symbolic thought that are distinctively human. When you realize how much information we learn and transmit through our cultures, through language, plus other forms of symbolic thought, and to think of that as an inherited system that adapts us to our environments, not genetically, but culturally, is very, very interesting. Here's a study that we're doing along these lines, which treats sacred texts as the analyze of genomes and cultural evolution. So what is needed for there to be a cultural inheritance mechanism? First of all, there must be something that's replicated like genes with a high fidelity across generations. And then what's replicated must be transcribed. It must be somehow translated into action. And so there's something like a genotype-phenotype relationship, except instead of a genotype, it's, we call it a symbotype, or something that's basically some body of cultural knowledge. And sacred texts fully qualify for this. Of course, it's replicated with high fidelity across generations. And the Bible and other sacred texts even has a segmented structure, like a chromosome. It's really interesting that way. And then the passages are differentially invoked, basically. In any given situation, then the pastor who's ever interpreting the Bible and basically selectively cites different sections of the Bible and interprets it, and then that results in action because religions are taken very seriously. And I love this picture here. This is a kind of iconic picture of the preacher. So here we have the text, the genome, the transcription, and the action. What you should do. So we've actually taken this quite seriously, and it helps us to resolve the paradox. And the paradox is, how is it possible for religions to be so diverse, different from each other, and yet share the same sacred text? So here we have a phylogenetic tree of Christianity, basically, with something very, very bushy, very different from each other, and yet they all draw upon the same Bible. How is that possible? And so here's a modern day variation. This is the Westboro Baptist Church. This is the church that has become famous for showing up at funerals and being extremely homophobic. And then at the opposite extreme, you have your progressive churches that are welcoming and basically celebrate diversity. And this kind of seems hypocritical from some perspective. We like to say, oh, you can justify anything from the Bible, as if that's a criticism. But when we think of the Bible as like a genome that's capable of adapting foods to many situations, then it becomes more interesting and sheds different light on. So this leads to a method that we have started to employ, because one of the things that's preserved is biblical citations. So you can go to websites and you can get the sermons and they're citing the Bible all over the place. You can go back in time and you can get biblical citations. And so this means that we can do something quite similar to genetic analysis. So what we did was we took two churches very different from each other, Westboro Baptist Church, highly conservative, a church in Maine, which was highly progressive. We chose them because they had lots of sermons on their website, so we could get a large sample of biblical citations. And then we have generated graphs like this. And if you're a biologist, this might look like a genetic heat map, basically. This is saying what genes are expressed, but this is what books of the Bible are expressed. So we have the 63 books of the Bible here. And what we see is, although it's the same Bible, these two churches are citing it in very different ways. Okay. Now this is a crude book, and so let's take one book of the Bible that's cited by both churches, that's the Gospel according to John, and let's zoom in, and we see the chapters of the Gospel according to John are also differentially cited. Well, let's take one chapter, John 3, that's cited by both. We zoom in still further, and that's differentially cited. And so if you look, same Bible, but if you look at how the Bible is being expressed, we find it's very, very different from each other. And so finally, there's one verse that's cited by both, and that is, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." We also study one of our projects in Binghamton. It's called the Binghamton Religion and Spirituality Project, where we study all of the congregations in Broome County, all 200 of them, as if they were a big cultural ecosystem, like so many cultural species in your backyard. Okay? And so there's two churches. These are both United Methodist churches. But if you're a churchgoer, you know that even within a single denomination, you get big differences along that conservative progressive. So Steve Heiss is a good friend of ours. His daughter was actually one of Ann's graduate students. And he's very progressive. He was so progressive that he actually got in trouble with the United Methodist Church for performing gay marriages before that was authorized by the UMC. And Bill Pucky, wonderful man, but he's very much of an evangelical guy. And so he definitely preaches strong in the word. And so we were able to gather biblical citations from our local churches. And to make a long story short, there's a family resemblance between the conservative church in Binghamton and the Westboro church, and the liberal church in Binghamton and that other liberal church. And you can do statistical methods. You can calculate distance measures and things like that to relate these different churches to each other. Now, here's another interesting thing that's happening, of course, with environmental. Let's say that you are a pro-environmental person, but you're also a Christian. You might feel moved to develop a form of Christianity that basically is a green Christianity. But let's say that you're a climate denier who also happens to be a Christian. In that case, you're going to spin the Bible basically in that direction. And so we can perform the same kind of analysis for these different versions of Christianity as we see here. And this one's a lot slicker than this one. A lot of money went into that production. So one of my graduate students is basically showing how are Christian churches adapting to a current problem of environmentalism along these lines. Okay, well, let me get back to multi-level selection. Remember the water striders, where we had the selfish water striders and the altruistic water striders. And the rule is, within groups, altruism is vulnerable to exploitation. Okay, so selfishness beats altruism within groups. But groups of altruists do better than groups of selfish individuals. That's basically what it is in a nutshell. And what goes for genetic evolution and what goes for water striders also goes for us, not just genetic evolution, but also cultural evolution, and even our choices on a day-to-day basis on how we're going to behave. All of us are flexible, the evolutionary terms are phenotypically plastic, and we're capable of being altruist or non-altruist depending on the circumstances. So, as a thought experiment, imagine that you're an altruistic person surrounded by non-altruists. What are your options? What can you do? One, you can leave, if you're lucky enough to do that. Two, you can attempt to change the behavior of your social partners. Good luck with that. Three, defensively turn off your own altruism. Or four, remain altruistic and suffer the consequences of exploitation. And who would counsel someone to do four? I think this gives us sympathy for individuals that defensively turn off their altruism just in order to survive. Now, in addition to that, there's just social predators, basically. They're like a water striker, and they're basically out to get you, even under any circumstances. So, one of the things we do in Binghamton is we measure this in people. We ask, if we otherwise measure, how pro-social are you? How inclined are you to help others and your community? Or are you, on the other extreme, are you someone who basically cares only about yourself and really very unmotivated to help others? Surveys, turns out to be, are quite accurate, and you can test this by cross-validating with different measures. And this is a map that's based on a survey that was given to thousands of public school students in which we measure their pro-sociality, how other-oriented are you. We also get their residential locations, and we can create these maps that show dark areas in which these are neighborhoods in which most individuals are pro-social, and light areas in which most individuals are not pro-social. I always love showing this map because I'm a biologist, and this map looks so much like the distribution map of a species, doesn't it? Couldn't this be the distribution map for a plant species, for example? And if you were a conservation biologist and your interest was to make the species more common, what would you do? Why is the species here and not here? What would happen if you're a transplanted? Probably it wouldn't do well, because the reason it's not there is because the growth conditions for it are not favorable. And so if you really want the species to become more common, you have to provide the growth conditions for the species. So to think of human social strategies that way, to think of the decision to be pro-social or not, that's like a species or like a strategy that can succeed or fail in certain situations, in different situations. And if you want to make pro-sociality more common, you don't just counsel people to be pro-social. What you do is you provide the growth conditions and the pro-sociality wins the Darwinian content, basically. And then people might become pro-social without being told. So this is also evolution in your backyard. Not genetic evolution, but it uses the same logic. And I think in some ways it's even more important, because after all, it has to do with our quality of life. So to summarize, we have the backyard jungle. Every species has a story to tell, a fascinating and important story to tell. And some of the best studied species are the ones in your backyard. You don't have to go far away to get these wonderful stories about organisms adapted to their environment, genetic evolution and warp drive, that evolution takes place on ecological timescales, a single generation can cause a genetic evolutionary change, and then the idea that there's much more to evolution than genetic evolution. And more or less all of the fast-paced changes taking place all around us you very much. And my new book, Does Altruism Exist, is basically a summary of altruism. What is it? How does it succeed in a Darwinian world? How does it fail in a Darwinian world? And it's a rethinking of the concept of altruism. So I thank you.
Learning and teaching.
discover is that it takes place spontaneously with almost nothing that resembles formal education at all.
Formal education is a pretty impressively effective invasive species.
You could say that. And all sorts of errors are being committed with formal education, which you can detect basically. So this makes it possible to design the school environment to be much better than it is. We had the opportunity to do that in Binghamton with a program that ultimately was discontinued, but not for lack of its success. And we were able to take a bunch of at-risk students that had flunked three more of their courses the previous year and caused them to do as well as the average high school student on the Regents exam. And there's a single set of principles, and so much of it has to do with creating an environment that's trusting and nurturing and playful and so on. Basically, an environment in which you can be safely be pro-social and to build in the ingredients for that. That's also true with businesses. We're brainwashed into thinking that businesses must be highly competitive, that they must maximize their profits, so on and so forth. But it turns out that the best businesses are the ones that are really nice to their employees, that are cooperative, that foster cooperation, and that also, as businesses, are responsible in the larger ecosystem. So there's a common set of principles underlying all of these different social forms.
There was a period of time when I can remember about a few years ago where the term social Darwinism was pounded upon.
Right.
Largely because it so heavily involves survival of the fittest as its characteristic. It seems like you're reviving social Darwinism, the other side of the equation.
Exactly.
And maybe you're saying that we shouldn't look so negatively on the term social Darwinism.
Well, that's exactly. My next book is titled The New Social Darwinism, and I'm going to try to rebrand social Darwinism. When you look at how social Darwinism earned its reputation, it's actually very interesting. What it refers to, and always has referred to, is this survival of the fittest, basically, mentality in which the haves of society are the most fit, the have-nots are the least fit, and it's nature's way for that to be. So therefore, you should not have a social safety net, you should practice eugenics, basically, and so on and so forth. And so that position is what's been called social Darwinism. But Darwin didn't think that. And most of the people that have been trying to take evolution and apply it to social policy did not think that. So it's a stigma, basically, that's been applied to evolutionary theory falsely. And yet it's very tenacious. Most people, when you think of evolution and policy, they go and they think of social Darwinism. So that's one of the things that definitely needs to change.
That's removed the heritability component.
What's that?
It has removed the heritability component.
you know, replicator dynamic has to have something like a heritability component. There has to be a functional equivalent to a heritable component. Learning, I mean, B.F. Skinner, the behavioral psychologist, coined the term selection by consequences. And what he was trying to say there is that the process of operant conditioning, basically reinforcement learning, produces an outcome similar to natural selection. We get selected by the consequences, and it's filtering through the instincts that evolve by genetic evolution, which cause us to adopt some behaviors and not others. And I just think there's a wonderful example that I love to give. It goes back to education. So there's an experiment in which you give kids a problem to solve, and then when they solve it, you praise them in one of two ways. Either you say you're so very smart, or you say you're so very hard worker. And then you give them a choice of two problems to solve. One which is the easy problem, and the other which is the difficult problem. And the kids that have been praised for being smart choose the easy problem so that they can continue to appear smart. Those that have been rewarded for being hard working choose the hard problem so that they can appear hard working. Now just imagine repeating that day after day after day after day, and who's going to learn the most? So this could actually explain the cultural difference. Why do Asians do much better in school than white Caucasians, for example? Is it genetic? Well, we don't know, but it could be something as simple as what you get praised for.